Welcome to our week, Marilyn Horse. It's New Year, and we've been just discussing. I must admit, I fell asleep in the fireworks, but I heard this commentary in the background, and I just went out like a light, because, of course, we're 1 hour further on than you in the UK here in Spain, so I've got a good excuse. But it's all over the press, Marilyn. I know you didn't see it.
No.
But the Mayor of London has really lost it. But they all do, don't they? I mean, whether you've got Nicola Sturgeon, Mark Drakesford, any of them, they're power mad, perhaps. But, I mean, to go woke and say London's open, in other words, to everyone, we're inclusive, exclusive, whatever, clusive. And it was all about selling woke. That was an utter disgrace. What the world is thinking about.
Well, it's not a platform for it, is it? It's just a time for celebration, not rubbing our noses into something we don't actually want, you know? And I mean, okay, we do have ethnic minorities here. We do have, and the ones that settle in and contribute, fine. But there's a hell of a lot that don't. And to be, you know, raising a flag and, you know, everything about gender stuff was raised, wasn't it? I mean, it is
it
not
was.
A platform for it. It's a celebration. Happy New Year. That's it. It shouldn't be used as grandstanding for something else. And I mean, thank goodness I didn't watch it, because I don't think I would have gone to sleep. I just thought, oh, we're supposed to have gone to a party. So Happy New Year, everybody. We're supposed to have gone to a party. Lady was ill, so I just stayed in. And I thought, you know what? I really can't be bothered, because I just sort of thought the bar humbug in me is... Because I saw Sydney's lights and I saw Auckland, because my stepdaughter lives over there. And then I thought, oh, I can't be bothered not going to a party. And I can't be bothered because, quite frankly, we're supposed to have a financial crisis in this country. So unless the king was paying for it, we've got no money to pay these people, no money to pay that people. How can you possibly justify burning what is thousands and thousands of pounds of cash on fireworks? Maybe I'm just a miserable old so-and-so, but for those people that have struggled to have any food over Christmas, isn't that a bit of a smack in the face?
Yes, I remember back, because we, as you know, do a lot of boating and over here in Spain, and we had a fireworks display in Salou, maybe you know it as, and that's good because it's for the tourism. And we got front seats on the boat, obviously, right on the shore. And it was absolutely phenomenal. And it did cost money. But where does the money come from? It came from the tourists, to entertain the tourists. It was cost effective. Mm. This was all about Sadiq Khan. There's a big notice at the beginning of the blooming programme before I fell asleep saying, presented by Sadiq Khan. It was something out of Hollywood.
I won't dodge. Even if I'd stayed up to just before midnight, I'd have gone to bed. I can't bear him. He's so, oh, goodness me, no. Oh, dear. I do worry. If this keeps on, because not everybody should be here. Not everybody is a contributor to our nation. There's a guy this morning I saw who, in the news, top news in the Telegraph, he's a leading Albanian criminal gangster. And he's here in the UK. He's actually got a sort of residency. I think he's got a British passport. But he's in prison. When he comes out, the National Crime Agency, don't the government listen? The National Crime Agency have said when he comes out, he is going to be a danger to the public. And he's waving that flag like they all do of his human rights. Now, this man is a criminal gangster making £8 million. What about the rights of human rights of the people who he's harmed? And yet, here we are, he's still in this country, just one of many Albanians that have done no good for us whatsoever, other than cause harm. It drives me mad. It honestly drives me mad. So I'm already in a bad mood for 2024.
Well, there you go. A lot of people are talking about mood. That's important. People used to look forward to a new year. Mm. But I get a deep sense that people are not doing that anymore.
No, I
don't know what we got to look forward to.
Well, that's how I feel. I used to think, you know, wonder what this year will bring. And now I'm just thinking, I don't want to know. Thank goodness we don't know, because I can't see a lot of joy coming forth somehow. We'll have an election, won't we? and all the nonsense around that will happen. And that's going to drag on all year until we actually do have one. Then we got the news that Rishi Sunak was having private meetings with Dominic Cummings. I mean, they are just all, as you say, power crazy, career driven, egotists, and a load of numpties, actually, when it comes to making any sharp decisions.
Yeah, and you've mentioned there are many. One was highlighted by the Mail Online, the Sudanese man that it's been messing about for nearly 10 years, going between UK and Sudan, member of ISIS. And they can't pin. Well, no, he's been pinned, but he keeps coming in and out.
Yes, I saw that one.
He's got British citizenship, but he's also got human rights. Mm-hmm. Now, the simple facts are, if we had anything about us, we would get out of ECHR. We would get out of all the accompanying acts of Parliament that are way past their sell-by date and say, no more. Let's live in the real world. Mm-hmm. You are illegal. You are criminal. You're not coming in. And then the real tasty bit is to get rid of the elite, which is not going to be easy because it's the elite, in my opinion, that are the real criminals. Who are the elites? Well, it's anyone that wants to fill our universities, our educational establishments, with woke ideas, with open borders, letting anybody in for educational purposes. This is the real problem, why our culture is changing, why London now has 37% born British, that's all. Why this morning my nearest and dearest was watching, yes, I think it was GB News. They had a Vox Pop session about the fireworks. And she turned to me and said, is anybody English left in London?
Well, this is the point, isn't it? I mean, what worries me is that is London. If you go up north and you go to some of the small towns and villages there, the heritage of being English, why shouldn't we want to preserve our heritage? You know, why shouldn't we be able to be English and British? You wanted to come here, so why should we lose our values and be swamped over? I'm sorry, I am not racist. I'm not racist. I just think you would not get away with this in any other country. You would not get into America. I mean, I don't understand why. Surely it's possible. If you created heinous crimes like this guy from Albania has done, who's waving his human rights flag, why can't they be stripped of their citizenship? Can they be? I don't know.
Yes, he has it. It was stripped from him, the Sudanese anyway.
Right, yeah, but the Albanian guy hasn't.
Yeah, that's right. But it is possible. Of course it is. Everything is possible. It's down, Marilyn, to political will.
Yes.
And who is running the country? And as I said on a previous broadcast, the thing about Tony Blair 10 years ago, seeking and getting advice from the civil servants about people flooding the country. And I believe he was furious at the time. And it was exactly the same advice that those same civil servants a decade later have given to Rishi Sunak. It's they that control the country.
Yeah, the people hidden behind the curtain. You never know who they are. I mean, they are the establishment, aren't they? The people, we have no idea, but they are surrounded within and protected within the civil service. I mean, the other day there was an article during the Christmas break where they couldn't get any pay rises. So what they've done, they've very cleverly promoted people instead, which is just, I mean...
the answer is simple, as I mentioned on that same broadcast, that you've got to have a situation where you can say to a civil servant, you are sacked.
Yeah.
Hosky. That's absolutely the real problem.
That's right. We don't do that anymore, do we? People are people screw up in councils, whatever. They, even if they are got rid of, they come out on enormous payoffs and benefits and, you know, the huge pensions. They don't get stripped of that. I mean, that's what I think should happen to the police. If you've got a corrupt police officer, those police pensions should be out the window.
Right. My next topic was exactly that. Police are completely woke. They know the law. There's so many laws. There are laws in existence now that will stop. For example, what a cheek. Eritreans coming over to this country yesterday with long sticks about what's happening. Well, we're not interested. And they're poking away at the police. The police don't do anything until the hit squad came and didn't do very much anyway. What are these people being allowed to protest for?
Well, it drives me mad. I mean, there was another thing about the state of London, senior police officers, and I don't think they're wrong, saying that London, with its drugs and layabouts and stuff like that, is now right up there with New York. And that doesn't come as any surprise.
No, knifings instead of pistols. That's the only difference.
Yes, exactly. Because the funny thing is, I was talking to my son yesterday, who lived in New York for about 3 years. And I said, I never felt threatened when I used to go and see him in New York. I never felt threatened. I'd go on the subways, etc. But I do feel threatened when I go into London. Even during the day, I really feel intimidated. I don't like it. But then, interestingly, my daughter-in-law was saying, with New York, whilst it had been cleaned up during lockdown, it all went AWOL again because people started flooding into the subways and sleeping out there. And the problem has like built up again to before it was all cleaned up. So she said she knows lots of her friends that still live and work in New York who won't use the subway because it is such a dangerous place again now. Yeah. But I think London is. I mean, when is it that senior police officers had said, you've got fentanyl on the streets of London. You've got, what is it, naxotine or something. It's something that's...
Yeah, I know what you mean. Wait,
I can't remember the name of it. It begins with an N. But, I mean, yeah, it's a factory-made opioid, isn't it? Like what fentanyl is as well. I mean, but just dreadful. It's just dreadful.
Well, it's just different. It's 100 times stronger than fentanyl. Well, I mean, that's 100 times stronger than any other opioid. It's what's happening is unbelievable. The other thing that is happening, and please, everybody, beware of this, multiculturalism, Mr. Blair, back to Mr. Blair. How wonderful it is. No, it isn't. It's been caught. Emperor's new clothes, absolutely now, because this is very simple. They don't want to integrate.
No, they don't.
They want to caliphate. They want to take over.
Yes, yes.
7% of the people in the United Kingdom that literally want a caliphate.
Yes, that's right. That's absolutely right. That's absolutely right. I think practically, I think people, when they go and live in another country, I mean, I was an expat, you stayed living there, but when I was an expat in Portugal, I think by nature, you veer to your own culture because you've got a thing like humour is different, isn't it? You know, your humour, your interests, your politics, everything about the country, and you do veer towards those groups of expats. So we do it as Brits. But I think it's the same, but almost sort of worse here because they don't want to really integrate. They don't. They come and sit in their silos and live like off benefits, and not all of them, obviously. That would be extreme, but unfortunately, there's too many that do.
Marilyn, we are being lied to. We are being brainwashed at every level. We are told to feel guilty because we're white.
Yeah,
or
yeah.
Whatever the thing is, but especially white. It's not very fashionable at the moment.
No, it's right.
How are we brainwashed? A dead simple way of finding out. Watch commercial television, any channel, you will see advertising. Now, bear in mind, depending on where you are in the country, between 7 and 12%, some people say 14%, are not white.
No.
Native English people.
They're not. No, they're not.
But will you tell me why 70% of the people on all the adverts are non-white.
Well, this is the drip, 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 isn't it? It's having to be, you have to put your percentage of ethnicity into certain companies. I mean, I was at a university. I was doing some help, doing some interviews for, well, last year now, obviously. And principally, all the students that were applying, they were all from Nigeria. And I kept saying, and it was for a hospital. I can't remember what they were applying for now, mental health nurses or something. I can't remember. But I actually said afterwards, I said, where's all the white people? Where's all the people that, all right, or the, I don't know, Europeans or whatever? Why are they all coming from Nigeria? But you see, I think that's the whole thing. You have to tick the diversity box and the equality box. And but that's not that that's not equal. You've sent me 90% applicants are from Nigeria who can't actually. You can't really, I'm not being funny, understand them. Their accent is so thick, so strong. You can't have people going into a medical profession where you can't understand what they're saying to you. It's bonkers. But I honestly believe they've chosen those to come in because they could have been critiqued for being xenophobic white.
Yes. And I'll make you even madder now because we mentioned something last week about Ms. Blank, Aviva Presidente, the lady who wouldn't have a man on the board unless she chose him specifically. And it's got further. This woke woman in extreme has now been given a damehood, having been criticized from top to bottom, even by the left, might I say. She's been given a damehood.
You see, I think when you're doing this New Year's honours list, I have absolutely no idea why Justin Welby was on the New Year's honours list, other than the fact that he
Oh,
put the.
that's easy.
Yeah, well, he put the crown on straight, didn't he? That's why.
Exactly. It's as
He
simple as
didn't
that.
drop the crown. So, oh, yeah, let's give him enough. What in heaven's name has he ever done for what he actually represents, which is the Church of England and,
Don't forget
he's
that was King
King
Charles's
Charles.
personal recommendation or his advisors. Of
I
course,
know,
Charlie was
but
behind it.
then you've got which I know several people who live in Norfolk who are absolutely outraged that four people on their county council have been awarded. I mean, their children's services and their county services are awful in Norfolk. They have an appalling record of dreadful support for mental health. So I said, oh, I see. Would that because do they live near Sandringham and make the king cakes or something? Is that why they've got an award? I think when you are drawing up a list of honours, it should be justified. On what grounds did you choose that? On what premise
To be
was that?
fair, 70% are justified because,
Oh, are they?
they receive the OBE, the CBE, because they've genuinely done some very good
Okay.
charity work for Donkey's Years. But
Right.
of course, star dust is sprinkled over people that we know, inverted commas, and they're the ones that hit the headlines. And
Yes.
they're the ones that are civil servants, totally incapable of doing their job. And automatically get. Sorry, civil servants, you are nice people individually. It's the organisation. No, I withdraw that remark immediately. It's the disorganisation, which leaves us to James Daly. James, of course, is Bury North. And he said, forgive the language, all this misbehaviour on our streets. Within and without our families is because of crap parents. Now, there are ways of saying things. Perhaps this is
Absolutely.
one of them. But is he right fundamentally?
Well, fundamentally, I couldn't believe it when I read it. I thought, oh, what? It's the sort of flyaway remark you might say, privately, like, oh, God's sake. So if you like now analyze this, you should never, what an insult. At the end of the day, though, you cannot get away from the fact that a huge percentage of children who are antisocial, misbehaving, blah, 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 have had difficult childhoods. They maybe have had poor parents, as in poor in their own parenting. But he's a Tory MP, isn't he?
Yes.
And I wrote on Twitter, you know, before you go around slagging the children off and all of that, you need to be accountable for 13 years of being in power, where you have completely decimated early years support down to about zero, with nurseries closing. On top of that, several years ago, your party literally closed down two-thirds of children's centres, which are an absolute lifeline to young parents. Kids don't, they're not born with a guidebook. So you get young people, you have, you know, the whole structure of being a parent and a family now is just fragmented, isn't it? You don't used to, what you used to say, it takes a village to bring up a child. You don't have auntie down the road or granny around the corner. Everybody goes off and they work here and they work there and they have their babies. And their actual family support network is not there. And perfectly nice, pleasant, lovely families do used to go to a Sure Start or Home Start or a children's centre for support. And it wasn't just for kids to go and play. I mean, you had sessions there when you could be discussed about breastfeeding or discussed with this, discussed. They'd have little meetings for dads who were struggling. All that's gone. So you can't just go with a sweep of the pen and say, oh, it's about crap parents. No, it's about crap governing.
There's a lot of guilty people in this. There's been another report issued. I know I'm getting in on my hobby horse, but I think it's absolutely fundamental. And that is, we are the worst country in the world to give the ladies the most important job ever in the whole world. And that is having the choice to stay at home
Well, this
and
is
look
it.
after the kids. Now, it's not a choice if the government are not supporting them, as
No,
they should do. But
exactly.
this recent report has come out once again, comparing 30 years ago with now. It's changed dramatically, the number of people scooting off back to work for social reasons, very often. And actually, you're worse off financially, even with the
Oh,
rubbish state
yes.
of Great Britain, you're
Yeah.
actually worse off. You're rushing round, picking up your kids, usually a bit late, getting frazzled, just so they can go on a horse ride. You think that's what's going to make their life? No, it's not. If mum stayed at home until the children were of a certain age, oh, that would contribute so much, Mr. Daly,
Well,
to your problem.
I don't disagree with you, but what I think is so difficult for mums today is looking after a baby isn't exactly inspiring. I think it comes as a great shock to some women when they have a baby that, ugh, I am exhausted. I mean, I can remember, I can still remember that exhaustion, thinking, I don't know how I can even stand. And if you've had quite a high up job, if you've had a you're really doing well in your job, and there you are, you have this baby, and it's a huge, whilst you love the child and all that, it's a massive change from the life you were having with the banter in the office and the responsibility and the accountability and being, you know, head of this or whatever, or senior manager of that. And then you're like, oh, okay, so I did all this just to change nappies, clear up puke, and, you know, being at home all day. And it is, I mean, it is ostensibly boring. I mean, and if you've got a mother who's feeling depressed because she has left work, and, you know, then which way do you play it? I mean, and also the financial situation, I don't think, I mean, my kids have got no choice. They've all had to go back to work, you know, but they did take a year off. They used a whole year of maternity leave, but even then it's hard. And but I was saying to my kids, you know, when you were born, there was no maternity leave. You left your job. You left your job. And there was no job waiting for you to go back to. You had to start again or not.
I was brought up, my parents went straight back to work.
You
Even in
were.
those days, oh yes, we had a
Right.
sweetie shop. So that couldn't shut. It was open 8 days a week, 25 hours a day. And I had to go on and muck in. And there are individual circumstances. And we've got to be careful not to lay another law down saying, thou shalt. But it's
No.
really as to step back and think, maybe of somebody else instead of ourselves. Is that putting things too strongly? I agree with you, and I know we both agree it is the most important job
Yeah,
in
it
the
is.
world,
It is.
bringing up
And
kids.
it's like when people go on, I'm actually being asked to get involved, funnily enough, with a group. Again, it's another university, talking to women perinatal and the people that and I said when I had my interview, I had an interview before Christmas, and I said, I some of these mantras that people come out with, like breast is best. Well, it probably is, but not if it's making you depressed. Not if you've got mastitis all the time and your boobs ache every time anyone touches them. Not if what you're doing is giving your baby colic because the baby, whatever you're eating, not eating, whatever, is AI, they're not satisfying the baby, or is, my daughter had 5 months of constant colic. It was absolutely awful. And I remember her when she was having her first baby, and she lived in Dubai, and she was so depressed with this child wouldn't latch on properly. We went to lactation classes, and she was getting so depressed. I said, Nikki, it really isn't worth it. Baby milk now, yeah, all right, it's expensive, but I said, it's perfectly good. I breastfed my first boy. I gave up with Nikki because of colic, and I absolutely didn't the twins. And I do not feel any better connected with one more than the other. There's no difference in their health. They're all four healthy kids. So I think these mantras that when you are young and you're having your baby, you feel very inept at the start, don't you? You're suddenly coming home, and this little person that you've just grown for 9 months is now a kicking, screaming human being, and it's terrifying. And then people are saying, oh, you must do this, you must do that. And no, find your
Yes,
own way.
antisocial at both ends of the body, of course. Right, we're going to move on quickly. And we're going to mention Joke of the Week. And
No,
I'll tell you what the
there is
joke
one.
was. Oh, yes. Scott Williams. He's a very good darts player.
Oh, is this? No,
And
it's not the 16-year-old, is it? No, he's brilliant.
no, he's brilliant. Yeah, he's got
Unbelievable.
50 grand already and he's not finished yet. But no, this is Scott Williams, and he defeated a German opponent in the international competition that is still going on. And he was callous enough to say, "We've won two World Wars and a World Cup, and now I've beaten you." It was a joke. Everybody laughed at the
Can't do
time.
that anymore.
Well, no, Sky Sports had to profusely apologize. Now, hang on. A, why should Sky Sports have to apologize? If anybody needed to apologize, it was the guy that said it. But it was a joke. We've got loads of German friends. And I'll tell you what, nobody quotes Basil Fawlty more than they do. Don't mention the war. They think it's horrendously funny. So this is where we are, Marilyn. We can't say anything.
You
It's a
can't,
load of
I know.
rubbish. It's a joke.
You can't. It's absolutely, you have to think twice now before. And it's so weird how it's sort of subliminally sort of soaked into your own mindset that, ooh, best not say that. Best not joke about that. Should I say this? You can't be that. I mean, when you look back at some of the things that were on and what was said, say 25, 30 years ago, I mean, you must remember the black and white minstrels. Oh, my word. Well, all these people were like dressed up like gollywogs, weren't they? Blackface and white gloves and mammy. You remember? I mean, can you imagine putting that out on every Saturday evening now? I mean, unbelievable.
Well,
Some things.
I did an interview with the black and white minstrels
Oh,
and
did you?
minstrels when they were at in their pomp. And
Oh.
this was the question I raised. Where's a bit of a giggle, a bit of a teaser? How do you feel when you're sort of waving your hands around and things like that? We don't bother, of course. It's a show, it's showtime.
Yeah, it's
But you
like, but
see, the people that are behind this want to make a point. They're called activists. Did
yeah.
you ever see anybody on television, whether it be a news program or not, with activist written
I can't
underneath
bear the word.
or influencer?
Oh,
Turn it off.
don't. I mean, who was it as well? That actor, who was it? Well-known actor who was critiqued because he's playing some role and he had to have his own nose, like to look, was it to look Jewish or something? And who was it? It's recently, it's a film that this well-known actor, and he's had a lot of critique because he has to have like, this false nose put on to make him look more like this. I don't know whether the guy was Jewish or what, but I mean, that's what acting is, isn't it?
Well, unless you're Pinocchio and you've got it built in, haven't you, then? Anyway, listen, we're going to go to Wales and Kingdom, of course, as we mentioned before, of Mark Drakesford. Oh, and what a legacy he's left now. I've just got direct from Wales, where we are represented, where we live when we're in the UK. We love it dearly. And the Welsh, I might say, because the vast majority of them are wonderful people. It's only the clowns, like in Scotland or wherever, they're getting there. The activists is what I'm saying. Now, by the way, the NHS, and we pour England a fortune into NHS Scotland and Wales, and they are failing miserably. Now you can easily wait 28 hours outside or in a corridor in A&E, and the last pay dirt to hit was the fact that the ambulance drivers gave up because they only attended one accident in the whole day. The rest of the time they were standing around. They individually, A&E paramedics, had to phone a local taxi service to get somebody into hospital. What is that about?
Oh, it's just dreadful. And you could never imagine that we would ever be in this mess, could you? Be honest. I mean, it's just outrageous. Outrageous. And there's all what worries me is there's so much chat going on about it, but where's the real action? I mean, is Keir Starmer going to be doing any better? I mean,
No, I'm frightened to death
Oh, me too.
because 85% chance, according to the bookies, of Sir Keir getting in. It will be no better. I can see it being worse.
I agree with you. I totally agree with you because if the money's not there, how are they going to make the money? How are they going to redeem this? It's all you don't see or hear any real policies, do you, at the moment? Which is probably they're probably keeping their powder dry because they don't want the Tories to seemingly nick their ideas.
Yeah, I think there's a lot going to happen in the next.
It's a whole 12 months, 11 months, whatever. No way of knowing. It's a short time, but it's a long time. A whole day, an hour in politics can change, can't it? We've
Exactly.
seen that last year, how quickly it can turn around. But it's going to be interesting and sort of somewhat amusing, I think, to see what people come up with. But I just despair about the NHS. And then the two people who were leading the junior doctors' strike, I don't know if you saw that, and now thinking of going to Canada. Hello, turncoats. Talk about disloyal to the people that you've brought out on strike, and now you're going to probably go off to Canada. I mean, there should be, if you have been trained in this country in certain professions and the government has subsidized what you're doing, then there should be, I think, if you like, sort of golden handcuffs, if you like, where you are handcuffed to that job for a couple of years, say, and if you have to give something back, and if you don't, then you have to pay back what. And I think there's lots of people that do that. You do an MA, if you do an MA, and your organisation pays for it, £40,000 for you to do it, they're not going to let you just shove off and work somewhere else. I mean, my daughter-in-law was in that situation. She's now worked her time and she could now go somewhere else. But you've invested. You should be entitled to say, well, if we're going to fund this or help fund it, then you have to work here in that profession for 2 years,
Soft,
3 years.
soft and stupid Britain.
Absolutely.
And I'll give you some more ammunition for that pistol you're firing at the moment. In the last 3 weeks, the junior doctors have worked actually 4 days over Christmas time. Wouldn't we all like to do that? That is, well, they are aficionados of the Hippocratic Oath. It's disgraceful.
Well,
And
this is it.
if you want to prove anything, this is the last nail in the coffin. The doctors in Scotland, SNP in charge there, settled for 12% months and months ago. So why can't they settle for 12% instead of 35% south of the border? The answer is simple. It's political, no more, no less. And where is this government? At least it should be banging drums and pointing in the right direction.
They don't know, do they? They're just, as I said, just a bunch of numpties. They're not dealing with the crises in education. They're not dealing with the shocking number of stabbings that are out on the streets. They're not dealing with the county lines that is so often behind all these stabbings, where the youngest one who has like joined the gang maybe has been disloyal in some way and is there stabbed or shot. You just don't ever hear anything coming out about what we're doing. You can take out a whole gang with a National Crime Agency, but there's another one popping up across town. And the National Crime Agency do a fantastic job in this remit. I really do. But when you're sort of, when they're going to the Telegraph to say this guy, like the one with the Albanian guy, and it's all the information from the National Crime Agency, they wouldn't do that unless they were desperate to be heard. I mean, because the government should be supporting them. And they don't. They don't respect young life in this country. It really concerns me. And we're going back to that guy who said about crap parenting. I mean, what a gaffe. But even if it was right, and it's not 100% right, they've done nothing for the early years. If you know, what was that thing? You give you a child till they're seven, I give you a man. And even younger than that, you have to sort it out by the time they're three. You've got to get that child stable. And they have decimated that. And then you get the kids that are, you know, running amok, that got nothing else to do. They closed down youth clubs. Wherever you go, anything that supported young people has been attacked, and there's no one, I don't know, even know who the children and family minister is now. Who's the youth minister? Have we got one?
Yeah, indeed. Look, we've run out of time, as we always do, way too early. I've got to, I don't know, something strange has happened. Madame, as you see there, in all her glory, has gone really woke. Yeah, I can see it happening to other people. And we've been talking in recent weeks about all these ladies that are getting, especially goalkeepers, what's it called, Sportswoman of the Year. And now they've got to rub insult into injury. In the CBE, MBE things, the goalkeeper again has won another for failing. And Madame, as you see her there, has failed, but in a beautiful way, because she's been taken on, not as a mascot, but as a player in a dementia football team. Now, hang on, I should pause for applause or laughter. I don't know. Tell us about this, and why did you get in there?
So my husband has dementia with Parkinson's, right? So I got involved last year thinking, how can I sort out his balance? What can I do to make it better? What can I do to get him out of the house? Because he, you know, I am his driver, his carer, everything else, all the rest of it. Anyway, so I looked up and did research on what is good for people with Parkinson's. And it came out that bowls was good, not tenpin bowling, but doing bowls because you've got your balance and all of that. And that's good. And then I saw walking football. So I was like, what? Walking football? Gosh. So then I found this group. And then from this group came this amazing dementia charity set in Bedfordshire, where I live, central Bedfordshire. And it's incredible. And there's all these things for dementia people that can help. They've got music for memory and all of this. But the thing with the dementia walking group is you aren't going to have a game if you don't have healthy bodied people that can, because some of them are really quite bad, and they sort of like do with the ball, dribble it a little bit, and it's going to take you forever to get to the end of the pitch. So you need healthy body people to sort of go in and kick the ball across and all that. So they said, would I have a go? Because they were short on able-bodied people. Like, oh, I've never played football in my life, even though I've got three lads. So, okay, I'm absolutely useless. So what do? I score a goal. And then the men are going, even the dementia men, whoo, you know, you're a dark horse, aren't you? I said, I don't know where that came from. It's beginner's luck. You know, beginner's luck. And then the next week, I go, oh, you've got to go over, do it again. I score three goals. Oh, Unbelievable. But you know what is astonishing is it's hard work because mentally you want to run and kick the ball. It's a free kick if you do. Trying to walk fast and not run or trot is it's really hard. It's you're doing it for an hour and it's hard. And then I mean, it would be funny, these men may be in their 70s with dementia, but they still not beyond having a tackle. One guy fell on his back twice and had to be helped up almost by a crane. But they don't, however their mind is, one guy can't even remember his name or which end he's supposed to kick, but he remembers how to kick. And he used to play for Millwall and he can belt the ball, but he nearly knocked me out with this like kick he came from one end of the pitch to the other. They have not forgotten how to kick a ball, even though, and you can pick the ones out that were really good players in their youth, you know, and it is such good fun. But my golly, it's hard work. It's hard work.
Three goal Marilyn should be
I
called down in
know, a
Lineker
hat trick.
next.
A
No,
hat trick.
I wouldn't
Woo.
deemed. Yes. This is, of course, to finally finish the best of Britain, because the best of Britain is brilliant. It's made
It
up of
is,
Brits and
but
people who have come here to be Brits. There's the clue.
that's the clue. That's the clue. And I would say anyone who's suffering like my husband is look up walking football in your area. And the other thing to help is also walking backwards is another exercise he has to do. Walking backwards to help with your balance. It's just little things that. And I have to say, where we were a year ago, he's still got what he's got, but mentally he's happier. He's out there chatting and laughing with these blokes, you know, that it's the banter. Oh my God. I mean, they are not woke. They're all in their 70s, early 80s, and the banter between them is really funny. And, you know, people that are not woke enjoy that.
Indeed, you get sent off in the real world for
Oh,
things like that.
it's
But who
crazy.
is in the real world? I think it's
I
me and thee.
am.
Marilyn, we'll see you, I'm going to
Happy
say
New
next
Year and
year.
God bless, and see you later on in the week.
Absolutely.